Our first speaker is Denis Cambouchner of the University of Paris 1. And Denis is the editor of a new edition of Descartes with Frédéric Debouzon, who will speak tomorrow. And he's written too much about Descartes that I can mention.
Too much, yes. Too much.
In any event, it's a great pleasure to have you, and the talk is titled Faith and Reason in Descartes' Reply.
Thank you.
And let me just say, there are about 40 minutes for presentation, and then we'll have time for discussion.
Thank you, Jorge. I present my talk in English, in a sort of English. But I want to pronounce my greetings in French. Je remercie bien vivement tous les organisateurs de la présente réunion, les responsables du Fanler Institute, de l'Institut français, de l'Université hébraïque de Jérusalem, Michael Rubach, et particulièrement Elhanan, un ami de longue date, dont je veux saluer ici le grand travail, dont la traduction des objections et méditations, objections et réponses que je ne malheureusement peux pas déchiffrer, est un des derniers éléments en date du grand travail, mais c'est tout à fait impressionnant. Donc c'est une très grande chose d'être parmi vous aujourd'hui dans ce si bel endroit, ces si beaux endroits. Et nous en sommes, enfin j'en suis extrêmement heureux. J'ai choisi de parler du rapport entre raison et foi. I'll get back to some texts that John Cottingham has mentioned and quoted this morning, and I think that we have a session devoted to these problems, which are of special importance in today's circumstances dans le monde d'aujourd'hui, and I think that Descartes may help us to confront a series of problems of today's world. John, Emily, the colleagues who have joined this meeting will perhaps show me I'm wrong, but the problem of Descartes' religion doesn't seem to me to have been much studied in the English-speaking scholarship. I apologize in advance for my mistakes. I translated myself even in last minute, and my English is not what it should be. By contrast, we find in the history of the French scholarship a sharp and old divide between two interpretive lines. According to one of them, Descartes is a true Christian thinker, determined to promote the cause of the true religion, that is to say the Roman Catholic one, by bringing irrefutable arguments for God's existence and for the immortality of the soul. From the opposite point of view, Descartes is a pure rationalist who has just tried to make the religious authority, at least in Catholic land, recognize his philosophy as an orthodox one. He has used the theme of God's omnipotence in order to give the human science its metaphysical foundations, but this God, infinite and supremely perfect being remains a very impersonal and abstract one. Among the recent studies, we find two books which represent those opposing options. Anne Staquet in Descartes et le libertinage regards Descartes as a crypto-libertine thinker. On the contrary, a Mexican colleague, Juan Carlos Moreno Romo, in a book called Vindication del Cartesianismo Radical, sees him as a Catholic champion of the Counter-Reformation. It matters little if none of these two studies appear really outstanding from an academic point of view. The question is still, shall we ever be able to decide between those options? What can we actually say about Descartes' Christian sincerity? We all have in mind the precautions taken by the author of the Discourse on the Method in order to protect the revealed truths from his general doubt. Descartes writes at the end of the third part, once I had established these maxims, the moral ones, but also the rules of the method, and set them aside in my mind with the truths of the faith, which have always held first place in my beliefs, qui ont toujours été les premières en ma créance, I took the decision that, as far as the rest of my opinions were concerned, I could freely undertake to rid myself of them, etc. Nevertheless, this clause, as well as some other ones, could appear insufficient, since it was easy to read them as purely rhetorical. As for the meditations, within which the methodical doubt is brought to its highest level, the Cartesian strategy is quite different. Of course, we read in the synopsis concerning the fourth meditation and the theory of error. In that meditation, there is no discussion whatsoever on sin, that is, the error committed in the pursuit of good and evil, but only the error that occurs in discriminating between what is true and what is false. Nor is there an examination of those matters pertaining to the faith or to the conduct of life, but merely of speculative truths known exclusively by the means of the light of nature. But those lines appear only in the second edition and are added on Arnaud's request in the fourth objection. Descartes' initial decision seemed to have been rather not to speak at all of the truths of the faith, except in the dedicatory letter to Dean and doctors of the Sorbonne, where he presents his whole undertaking as serving the Catholic Church and obeying the commands of the Fifth Lateran Council to all Christian philosophers. In the first meditation, we don't find any mention of those truths of the faith, except through the long-standing opinion of the existence of an omnipotent God. This opinion is not immediately called in doubt. It is rather used as a reason for doubting, and even as the strongest of all, for this God can have made me go wrong in absolutely all my conceptions. Apart from this, we have two passages quoted this morning by John Cottingham. First, at the end of the third meditation, a a pious moment of contemplation of the divine nature, and second, in the core part of the fourth meditation, a brief allusion to the divine grace. The more I am inclined toward one direction, either because I clearly understand that there is in it an aspect of the good and the true, or because God has thus disposed the inner recesses of my thought, the more freely I choose this direction. This was, on Descartes' behalf, a quite coherent strategy. Nevertheless, the resurgence of the reason faith problem in one or another set of objections was quite inevitable. Let's briefly examine those seven sets. The first objections are typically scholastic. They are the most scholastic of all. As such, they almost exclusively deal with the reality of ideas, with the Cartesian proofs for God's existence, and with the limits of human knowledge concerning God. We don't find here any stress put on the problem of doubt, nor on the status of faith. On the contrary, the third and the fifth objections linger on Cartesian doubt, but they are aimed at what we call Cartesian dualism, much more than they emphasize the subversive consequences of the general doubt. The same can be said, maybe paradoxically, of the seventh objections. The author Bourdin considers the Cartesian method as a very dangerous one, and in fact as impracticable, but doesn't seem to have found in the meditations, properly speaking, any cause for a theological scandal. Bourdin's theological concerns are in fact very limited. The questions concerning the harmony of reason and faith are therefore to be found in the second, fourth, and sixth objections, the sixth objections being a direct continuation of the second ones, as Frédéric de Buisson has shown in our forthcoming edition. The second objections, the author of which is very probably Mersenne alone, are explicitly presented as those which could arise in some minds not exercised at all in the kind of meditation that Descartes himself has cultivated. In consequence of this practice, his own practice, Descartes perceives by a very clear intuition of the mind some matters that seem doubtful and quite obscure to others. And so he's in danger of paying no sufficient attention to the points which will cause difficulty to the common minds. To present him these points will therefore be very useful if one wants his demonstrations to be improved in such a way that those common minds would be permitted with awareness of the divine power, rempli de la connaissance de la divinité. This will bring the defeat of the new race of giants, the libertines or esprit fort, and the triumph of the party of the side of the truth, le parti de la vérité. That's how the first objection calls into question the doubt concerning the corporeal things, is it real and serious, and asks why it would be inconceivable that a body would think. The second one objects to the third meditation that we have in ourselves and in our own perfections a sufficient basis for forming an idea of the supreme being. A third objection outlines the reproach of logical circle concerning the relationship between the knowledge of my nature, of my own nature, and that of God's existence, and asserts that even an atheist can clearly and distinctly know a theorem of geometry. It is with the fourth objection that we enter our subject, with the apparent opposition between some famous passages of the Holy Scripture and the assumption of divine veracity. And the fifth objection worries about the little number of things that the general rule of truth will allow us to believe. The problem of divine veracity will be raised again in the sixth objections, point five. God, the objectors say, may deceive us without injustice or wickedness if this contributes to checking men's pride and castigate their crimes or punishing their first father's sin, or because of some other causes which are hidden to us. What will the philosopher reply to this? Besides, there are Arnold's reservations at the end of the fourth objections concerning the points which may cause difficulty to theologians. First, Arnold says, the comments Descartes makes in the fourth meditation would give rise to the most serious objections if they were stretched to cover the pursuit of good and evil. Second, I should like our author to stress that in asserting that we should assent only to what we clearly and distinctly perceive, he is dealing solely with matters concerning with the science and intellectual contemplation, and not with matters belonging to faith and the conduct of life. Finally, there is a problem of the real accidents in the Eucharist. We believe on faith that the substance of the bread is taken away from the bread of the Eucharist and only the accidents remain. But the author thinks there are no sensible qualities, only shape, extension, and mobility remain, which cannot exist without such a substance. The distinction between these states and the substance being just a formal one. Now, how to explain the transubstantiation? The author should ponder on this matter attentively and diligently for not endangering the very faith, despite of his intention, which is to defend the cause of God against the impious. We have therefore to deal with two orders of questions. The first one concerns the conformity of the principles or conclusions of Cartesian philosophy to the positive content of revelation. The problem being how to make some determined truths agree with some other ones. The second order of questions concern the general rule of truth in its relation to faith. Given the Cartesian demand of certainty, what may be the status attached to the revealed truth? I will say very, very little of the first order of questions. The constant Cartesian assumption here is that there can be no real contradiction between the Holy Scripture and the right use of reason or the true philosophy. It is well known that the Holy Scriptures speaks to men in a human language. when this language is well understood, any apparent contradiction vanishes. For instance, it is not true that any passage of the scripture presents God as deceiving men. That would be especially absurd, since divine veracity must be considered as the first basis of all faith. As for the Eucharist, it is well known that Descartes presents this mystery as much easier to believe when one adopts his own principles concerning the nature and appearance of corporal substance than when one follows the Aristotelian principles. As he writes in the letter to Father Dinet, I insist that there is nothing relating to religion which cannot be equally well or even better explained by means of my principles than can be done by means of those which are commonly accepted. At a second level, however, we find the problem of formal definition of faith and of the certainty which is proper to faith. And here we meet the text of the second set of replies. Fifth point, let's remind the question, is the general rule which requires a clear and distinct knowledge for judging or and for determining oneself to anything, is this rule applicable to matters of faith? And in this case, shall we say that a Turk or any other unbeliever sins if he embraces the Christian religion without possessing clear and distinct knowledge of its truth? The Cartesian reply consists here in two arguments. First, one must make a distinction between the subject matter or the thing itself which we assent to, and the formal reason, here the principle, which induces the will to give its assent. Our faith concerns indeed matters that are obscure, fides est de obscuris, but the reason why we embrace this faith is not obscure at all. On the contrary, it must be said, clearer than any natural light. Second, moreover, the clarity or perspicuity by which our will is induced to give its assent may be of two kinds. John Cottingham quoted this text. One of them comes from our natural light, and the other one from divine grace. The formal reason of our faith, Descartes says, consists in a certain inner light which comes from God, and when we are supernaturally illumined by it, we are confident that what is put forward for us to believe, ea quae credenda proponuntur, please note these words, has been revealed by God himself. And we are confident that it is quite impossible for him to lie, and this is more certain than any natural light, and is often more evident because of the light of the grace, of grace. This seems to be a very peaceful explanation, not at all uneasy. It is also, for its main part, altogether orthodox. I had planned to quote a text of Aquinas, but I don't know if I may.
Yes, yes.
I have 10 minutes. It won't be enough. Faith implies assent of the intellect to what to that which is believed. Now the intellect assents to a thing in two ways. First, through being moved to assent by its very object, which is known either by itself or through something else already known. Second, the intellect ascends to something not through being sufficiently moved to this ascent by its proper object, but through an act of choice whereby it turns voluntarily to one side rather than to the other. And if this be accompanied by a rest of doubt or fear in favor of the opposite side, there will be opinion, while if there be certainty and no rest of this sort of fear, there will be faith. So the intellect of the believer is determined to one object not by the reason but by the will, and the act of faith is an act of the intellect determined to an object, to one object at the will's command. And yet, I go back to Descartes, about a very difficult question, the Cartesian peacefulness may appear a bit excessive. An important problem remains, that is, while referring to the inner light by which God supernaturally illumines us, Descartes does not say that this light makes us believe what we believe, but only that it lets us know clearly that we must believe it. And this point is even more obvious in a subsequent text, the letter of August 1631 to the unknown objector called Hyperaspistes, the champion. Descartes says here, in the reply to the second objections, I did not assert that by the light of grace we clearly know the very mysteries of faith, but only that we are confident that they are to be believed. To be believed. We are confident, confidimus. This is here a recurrent term. In the second reply, it was applied to revelation in itself. It is applied here to a certain necessity to believe of believing. The supernatural light by which we are illumined makes us see the revealed things as having been actually revealed, and so we embrace them as having to be embraced. But what is striking here is the indirect mode of speaking through which the question remains: to believe that something has been revealed to us, or that is the same, to believe we have to believe it, is it quite the same as, simply and absolutely speaking, to believe that? Of course, even in science, we have always two different thoughts, one of them relating to a certain object and the other one to the first thought itself with its proper qualities. We never give our assent to any evidence without recognizing it as an evidence. Nevertheless, in natural evidence, the mind begins, so to speak, with filling itself with its object, and it is on the basis of this cognitive experience that the will is led to give its assent. By contrast, in the belief of faith, the object is purely pointed out as an object of belief by an authority which makes us recognize itself in a quite specific way. This means that from a Cartesian point of view, the object of faith doesn't give rise to the same intellectual or cognitive consumption as the object of science or evidence, and that it retains, with regard to our thought, a certain coefficient of exteriority. We can find, I don't know if I come to the end of my talk, but we can find from this state of things a certain number of confirmations. First, one of them can be drawn from the very strange example Descartes has chosen for showing how the obscurity of the matter of belief may be compatible with the clarity of the former reason of this belief. What does he say here? when I judged that obscurity must be removed from our conceptions to enable us to assent to them without any danger of going wrong, the very obscurity is the subject concerning which I form a clear judgment. But the comparison is misleading. I can't, je ne peux pas m'attarder. I can't lean over this. Second, at the beginning of the same reply, we find another mark of discomfort in order to reassure the objectors concerning the range of the general rule of truth. Descartes says, what philosopher or theologian, what man using his reason has ever failed to agree that the more clearly we understand something before giving our assent to it, the smaller is the risk we run of going wrong. And that, by contrast, those who make a judgment when they are ignorant of the grounds on which it is based are the ones who go astray or who sin, who commit a sin, illos peccare, qui causa ignota judicium ferunt. We can make out here what renders the act of embracing a certain faith legitimate. It is nothing but the clarity of the formal reason, but if this clarity is sufficient to make the judgment valid, the fact remains that the highest security of mind will always be found in the clear understanding, comprehension of the object itself. This can be corroborated by several texts of the same period, especially the letter to Huygens, of October 10, 1642. This is a consolation letter. Huygens had just lost his wife 2 years before Descartes himself had lost within a couple of months his daughter Francine and his father Joachim. What is he saying here? That he has found in the consideration of the nature of our souls, as it is promoted by his philosophy, a very powerful remedy, not only to enable me to bear the death of those I have loved, but also to prevent me from fearing my own, though I love life as much as anyone. And he adds, although religion teaches us much on this topic, I must confess a weakness in myself, which is, I think, common to the majority of men. However much we wish to believe, and however much we think, we do firmly believe all that religion teaches, we are not usually so moved by it as when we are convinced by very evident natural reasons. In his edition of the letters of Monsieur Descartes, Lettre de Monsieur Descartes, Clerselier gave an amended text. We are not usually so moved by it, all that religion teaches, and that our reason cannot reach, as when we are in addition convinced by very evident natural reasons. The point is this: all that we are taught, not by our reason, but by religion, and this must result from divine grace, we wish to believe it, and maybe we think we believe it, but commonly, at least at the time when we would especially need it, those truths don't really move or affect us. This means that this belief is somehow derealized, unactivated, and it is the case because it is always an incomplete one. Let's summarize the question. Is the clear awareness of the necessity of believing, which is given with the Christian faith, is it a belief in the most absolute sense of the word, from a Cartesian point of view? This question is tied to the distinction we can make between two modes of belief. One of them may be called submissive, a belief by or for submission, and the other one assimilative, a belief by or for assimilation. The first one implies a profession of faith. Its main feature is the intention of calling nothing in question concerning the object of faith, and so its definition is somehow negative. In the second mode, on the contrary, the content of faith itself becomes an object of meditation in a mind which tries to become more and more convinced and inhabited by its object. That's, of course, the case in the Augustinian faith searching for comprehension or intelligence. The question is then to decide which one of these two modes of belief Descartes has proposed and which one is really Cartesian. In order to answer this question, we should follow the Cartesian statements about the divine grace. First of all, faith itself is undoubtedly a grace, and when this grace occurs, it must make itself known in one or another way. But has Descartes considered himself as the subject of such a grace? I think the answer is yes and no. Here I would like to point out three aspects. First, Descartes always presents himself as having received the grace which makes the Christian. See the third part of the discourse on method, la religion, the religion in which by God's grace I have been instructed from my childhood. And in the second replies, he speaks of an infidel who has at first no knowledge of the doctrines that which we Christians believe to have been revealed by God. So, in the terms of the letter to Hyperaspistas, Descartes, as any true Christian, believes and finds supremely evident that what God has revealed is to be believed, and that the light of grace is to be preferred to the light of nature. Nevertheless, we are not thus much informed about the way he was believing all this. Second point, Descartes always presents himself as absolutely deprived of the sort of grace which allowed the theologian to understand things that remain beyond the reach of purely human minds. In the six replies, point five, before examining some passages of the Old Testament which seem to deny to men any access to the truth, he declares, "As for these passages, I should be afraid of being accused of arrogance if I did not choose to be content with the replies already discovered by others, or I have never become involved in theological studies except in so far as they contributed to my private instruction, nor am I conscious of having so much divine grace within me that I feel a vocation for such sacred studies." Similar declaration had been inserted in the first pages of the discourse on the method. Last but not least, let us recall a passage of the conversation with Burmont, 1648, which starts from this other famous statement of the Discours de la Méthode about the long chains of reasons of geometers and of the model of they constitute for all the human knowledge. Burmont asks, "Is it not the case that in theology too, all the items are mutually related in the same sort of sequence and chain of reasoning?" Descartes replies, Undoubtedly they are, but these are truths that depend on revelation, and so we cannot follow and understand their mutual connection in the same way. And certainly theology, that is God's speech, must not be subject to our human reasoning, which we use for mathematics and for other truths, since it is something we cannot grasp or not fully grasp, not nos eam capere non possumus. We therefore must not undertake any examination of these truths, because that would mean to mitigate them with our ways of reasoning. That has been the mistake of the monks, who have opened the field to every sort of sect and heresy with their theology. I mean, says Descartes, the scholastic one, which before everything else should be eliminated, quae ante omnia exterminanda esset. It's a Burman's transcription. But the fact is not just that Descartes sometimes speaks of theologians in very harsh terms, especially, of course, in the letter to Voetius. It is also that concerning the divine grace, his language is not always respectful. Let's consider, for instance, and try to abbreviate. The letter to Mersenne of May 1637, it's just the moment when the discourse is published, concerning the famous statement of the third part, in order to do well, it is sufficient to judge well. Descartes writes here, the well-doing of which I speak cannot be understood in a theological sense, for there grace comes into the question, but simply in the sense of moral and natural philosophy, where no account is taken of grace. So I cannot be accused on this ground of the error of the Pelagians. It is as if I said that good sense is the only thing necessary to make a man of honor, an honnête homme. It would be altogether beside the point to object that it is necessary also to have the right sex and not to be a woman. We find here a paradox, which consists in saying, I cannot be accused to take no account of grace as I don't speak of it at all. And there is a tradition for this paradox, which is tied to the history of libertinism. You already find it in Montaigne's Essai sur les prières, Essay on Prayers, about the divine doctrine, which better keeps its rank aside as sovereign domineering than when it is mixed with human discourses, reflections, and arguments. To be kept aside, doesn't it rather mean for it a lack of sovereignty? No. But besides, the comparison used by Descartes doesn't seem very respectful with regard to its object. If the statement, good sense, is the only thing necessary to make a man of honor, has quite the same meaning as this one, in order to do well, it is sufficient to judge well, one compares here two different objections about a single statement. One objection is, for being a man of honor, one should need the sex which makes the man, and the other objection is, for being a man of honor, one should need the grace which makes the work good. But these objections are obviously unequally relevant and even not relative to the same thing, since the first one deals with the meaning of the word man and the second one about well-doing. In spite of Descartes' suggestions, the second objection is serious, but the first one not at all. And this, on his behalf, is a very strange casualness. Now, conclusions.
Please.
Just 2 minutes. What conclusions can we draw from all this? First, it is perfectly clear that Descartes has been in philosophy, that is to say, in his public speech in general, a great strategist who has practiced and endorsed a certain art of shading the matters he was dealing with. This is explicit in the discourse on the method, in order to make more obvious one angle or another one according to the circumstances and the addresses. But it is also clear that with respect to certain philosophical and ideological antagonisms, his intention was to maintain himself on a certain ridge line, to set up his opinions in a certain medium, and to avoid, at least in his published work, anything which would appear provocative, even in a crafty or muffled way. Second, as a pure philosopher, Descartes keeps himself at a certain distance from the Christian dogmas as such. We find in his writings one or two references to the resurrection of the bodies, but very few mentions of Christ and absolutely no consideration of the original sin. And so we'll never know at what degree Descartes has practiced and deepened a meditation of these dogmas. The most likely is that at least in his mature age, he didn't spend much time in this kind of meditation, but this doesn't mean that he didn't attach to them any sort of signification. Third, in any case, this use of reason teaches us not only that an omnipotent God exists, but that he's infinite in all his perfections, and that we who are finite and imperfect have to keep, with regard to him, a very profound humility, as it is said in the Passions of the Soul. And the seventh replies could speak of building a solid chapel destined to last for many years to the glory of God. As a result, some texts give evidence of a sort of coincidence and coextension between the Cartesian virtue of generosity and the Christian virtue of charity. Finally, in the second replies, Descartes speaks of an infidel who would embrace the Christian faith on the basis of some fallacious arguments. This man would not yet be a true believer, but he would instead be committing a sin by not using his reason correctly. This passage can be interpreted in two ways. The first one consists in saying that this man is not a true believer because he has not received the divine grace, but in a second interpretation, the beginning and the condition of the true faith will consist in a right use of reason, with the result that whoever uses well of his reason will be, for that reason, faithful. In this respect, Descartes' conception of religion should obviously be compared with Spinoza's and Kant's one. Thank you.
Thank you. Emily.
As I was listening, as I was listening to you talk about Descartes' unwillingness to go too far into matters of theology, I was thinking, ah yes, but what about his discussion of the Eucharist? Because in the fourth set of replies, there's like 5 pages about the Eucharist. So what do you think there was about that particular point of doctrine that made him feel like he could go ahead and pronounce upon it?
Of course, Descartes is very committed in the question of the Eucharist because he thinks he'll succeed in demonstrating the superiority of his own principles over the Aristotelian ones. So there is a series of developments, first of all in the replies to Arnaud, and then in the letters to Mélan on this point, which is for Descartes a very technical one. The problem is, it seems to me, we cannot enter the detail, the problem seems to me, what sort of gain of intelligence, of comprehension, Descartes has thought to be tied to his own principles in this matter, because the mystery remains. I think that he thought that the Aristotelian principles brought in this mystery some useless difficulties, some additional difficulties, and that according to his own principles, the problem was the mystery subsists but remains, but reduced to its simplest form, as it is told, as we are told by the Régulier, to reduce the questions to their simplest form. I could not just now enter the detail of this point.
John.
Yes, thank you very much, Dennis, for a very rich, very stimulating. On the light of faith, the two passages you quoted
yes.
struck me as very interesting, which I need to pay attention to more. One was the passage in the replies that the light of faith doesn't need us to know, only to be confident that they are to be believed.
Yes.
That to be believed, credendum, it's this gerundive construction,
yes.
gerund, which we don't have in English, and I don't think in French uh-huh. either. So it's quite hard to translate.
Yes.
But it's interesting that it also occurs in the fourth meditation, what the intellect proposes, affirmandum vel yes. negandum, sive prosequendum, sive fugiendum, to be affirmed or to be. So even there, without any explicit mention of faith,
course.
The idea is that there are certain things which the light says yes, compels to say yes, it's to be affirmed, to be. So I'm not quite sure how much weight we can mm-hmm. attach to the gerund. Mm-hmm. And the other passage was the letter to Huygens, the consolation. Mm. Religious, yes, however much we want to believe, we're not always carried forward. A lot depends on the always there, mm. because. Again, in the fourth meditation, Descartes speaks of dispositio or propensio. So God gives us not, I take it, automatic mm-hmm. assent, but a strong disposition. He disposes our minds, but of course our mind can be disposed. I can be disposed to eat, but not always hungry. So I just wonder about maybe the connotations of both the gerundive and the disposition terms are not quite, still leave room for debate, maybe.
Yes, this is another sort of difficulty in which we should enter more precisely. Of course, there is always an imperative mode, that is to say, the intellect shows to the understanding, the intellect shows to the will, quid sit eligendum, what is to be chosen. This is an utterance of the rule one the régulé. But the fourth meditation maintains the imperative mode. But in the case of the search of for truth, in the search for truth, in the case of the intellectual evidence, there is no obstacle. So the ascent is absolutely it is an absolutely full ascent, and the highest degree of belief. When I don't see anywhere any reason to call it in doubt. In the case of faith, I don't know, because there is this set of Cartesian statements which mark a sort of reservation. And of course, in the letter to Huygens, what is not so the things we want to believe and maybe we think we believe, and which don't persuade us so much, are relative to the other life. I think so, and it's not maybe the question is not of the whole range of the articles of faith, but it seems to me that in the especially in the letters, some Cartesian declarations mark not at all a skepticism, but a caution. A cognitive caution concerning the object of faith.
I think what you called shading is a very nice term for.
It's in the discourse, fifth part.
All right. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
And.